Well, good morning, everybody. We started 5 minutes late, so we'll also have another extra 5 minutes at the end. We just moved the schedule a bit today. I will be talking about Grail of Goodness on this conference. So, short introduction about me. My name is Hubert Kleinikink. I live in the Netherlands. I've been a Java developer for many years and got interested in Groovy in 2008. And I started a little blog with some blog posts about Groovy, Grails, Gradle, all the great stuff that's available in the Groovy community. So my style of blogging is basically just a short introduction and a lot of code. That's also the style of this presentation. So there will be a lot of code snippets and live coding, because this will be the only sheet you will see this session again. So the code that I will type here will be available on GitHub later this day. You can already write down the address and I can send a Twitter message later today, which also will contain the URL. So any people here who have used Gradle before? Okay, nice. So hopefully you will see some nice tricks you haven't encountered yet in Gradle, or maybe you have forgotten about it, and at the end of the session you still have something to take away. And maybe try something at home or in your project as well. So there we go. Let's start with a clean slate. First of all, if I want to create a build file, I can just use, for example, text editor. And just to get started, a very simple task. Oh, I did have two beers yesterday, so maybe my typing is go away. So there you go. So to invoke my task, good morning, I just can type the task name. This will start up Gradle, and it will also start up the Java virtual machine. And there's also an option in Gradle that's called Gradle Daemon. And with the Gradle Daemon, you can start up a background process, so you don't have the penalty of starting up the GVM each time you want to invoke tasks in Gradle. And the different ways to be able to start a daemon. There's a command line option. So you can just say daemon if you do tasks. But you can also have, for example, a gradle.properties file in your project where you can set the same properties. So I can say the is true. So when I restart my task, it's now even faster. Because the daemon process is started and it can reuse a running GVM, which is quite powerful. If you don't want to use the gradle.properties file in a project, you can also use an environment variable and set it, for example, into the Gradle ops options. And we can do it like this. So Gradle ops. Let's be so. I'm now setting an environment variable for this shell, and all the Gradle commands I will invoke will have the daemon enabled. So just so it now still runs in daemon mode. If you want to stop the daemon because of something that doesn't work, there's also a stop option in the Gradle command, which will stop the daemon. I will enable it now because that will be quicker now during the session. So if there are questions during the talk, just ask them. And maybe I can answer them, maybe somebody else can answer them. So it could be nice. So if you start out with a new project, one of the nice things about Gradle is there's the Gradle wrapper. And with the Gradle wrapper, you can generate basically some shell scripts. The shell scripts have code in them to be able to load Gradle if it's not available on your machine yet. So if you're on a project and you create a Gradle wrapper file, you can check it into the source control system. And every developer on your project just checks out those files, and they can run the shell script. And Gradle will be downloaded on their computers. They don't have to do anything for it. And to create such a wrapper file, we have different ways to do it. So there is an easy way. There's a wrapper command, which is not really official there. It's incubating, so maybe it will be removed, but for now it works. This is Gradle 1.12. I can just say Gradle wrapper. as a command. There we go. So when I look at my directory, I have some new files there. You can notice there's a Gradle directory, which contains some jar files, which are needed to bootstrap Gradle and download it from the internet if it's not available yet. There is the Gradle W, which is a shell script file on gradlew.bat file for the Windows users. So I could still do, I think it was already installed on my machine, so yeah, that's a quick one. If it wasn't, it would download first the Gradle 1.12 version from the internet, install it in my user home directory, and then it will be used for this command. Also, for those who haven't used Gradle before, and there's also command abbreviation, so you don't have to type all of it, only what's necessary to get it recognized as a task in your project. So I think even one letter is enough for this. Yeah, so that saves typing. Very handy feature, which is also used in camel casing if you have task names with camel casing, and very, very powerful. So if you use the wrapper command like we did before, it will use the current Gradle version you have installed on your machine when you invoke the wrapper command. If you want to do it differently, we can use a wrapper task in our build file, which is also possible. So if we open our build file, I can now create a new task. The name, it's called create wrapper, but it's of type wrapper. So that's the most important thing here. And now I can also use, for example, different Gradle version. So let's say I want to use Gradle version 1.10, maybe. So when I go back to the command line, I can say Gradle create wrapper, and then using the very shorthand notation. I don't want to see. There you go. So the create wrapper command has now task has now been has been invoked. And if I go back to my directory structure, I can look into my Gradle directory. There should be a Gradle properties file. Yep. So that basically contains some metadata about the Gradle wrapper, what's needed to get it started. And you can see here at the bottom there's a distribution URL property, and now it contains the 1.10 version of Gradle, because that's what I used as an extra configuration property for the wrapper task. So that's how you can play with it. It's also nice to see you can even, for example, if you're in a big company, create your own Gradle distribution with own rules and sets like that, deploy it to your intranet, and then use this Gradle wrapper properties and point it with the distribution URL to a location on your intranet, and then every developer has the same instance of a Gradle for all their projects. It's also very powerful. And also, if you want to really control what's happening, that's something you can do. We can also change the name of the script file that's generated. It's now the default, it's Gradle W. We could also use something else, for example, three in just random letters like this. So let's create a wrapper. And now I should be able to say, oh, I didn't have the 1.10, so now it already shows that it's downloading it. Now it's installed, it's loaded, and my task is executed. So you can also see the next time when I do the same thing, it doesn't need to download it again. It just uses the one that's already installed on my machine. So you can just confuse people and then use this script file name, and then they don't know. So besides the wrapper command to get started for a project, there's also another option. I won't show it here, but I will mention it. It was also Peter Ledbrook had a talk yesterday in the afternoon about LazyBones. And with LazyBones, there's also templates for starting up Gradle projects. So you can use LazyBones to get a pre-filled template basically for a standard Gradle project. Or you can write your own if you want to, that's also possible. But there's also a init command available. Ah, I already have a build file, so I'll just go to clean directory. So I can now say Gradle init. Let's see what's all the stuff that's generated now. So in this case, it generates the wrapper, like with the wrapper command we have invoked ourselves previously. So the init command will do the wrapper stuff as well. And it also generates a build creator file. And let's see what's in there. There's already some stuff. It's the default thing it's generated for a Java project, you can see here. So there's stuff about the Java plugin, how to set up repositories, dependencies. So it's just a Kickstarter and something to get started on your project. And there's also a settings.creator file with some stuff where you can keep it as basically a basic template and then customize it to your own needs. Just a way to get started quickly without, well, it's not that much typing in Gradle compared to Maven, but it's a way to get started at least. So if we look here and we say, for example, there is a Gradle project command. It should show some information about our project. So we can see here there's only one project because this is the one directory with the one project. It's named init, and it's named init because the directory of this project is the name's init. Maybe we want to try change it. The one thing we could do is change our directory name, but that's not really what we want. But we have also something else we can change. There was the settings file. And you can see here this line, root project.name. So maybe we want to call it createconf. So I will run this project task again. And now you can see here, our project is now named createconf. So if you want to change the name of your Gradle project, you have to do it via the settings.gradle file and change it there. We can also set a description for a project to be more descriptive. We have already some documentation on, for example, our project. We can open the build creator file. And this is too much information for me now. I can just say description. Maybe if I fill it in once, that it will stop. There you go. I've done this a couple of times already. So, yeah. Now it should stay away. So there's a description property on your project. So basically, if you open the build creator file, there's already an implicit property there that's a project property of a project class, and it contains a description. And it being grooving, we can do a multi-line description here. So we can say project name, let's call it project name using Gradle version. So we'd be able to say Gradle version. So I just added this, give this description property my value. When I go back to the command line and then do the Gradle project task again. Yep, that's true. Thank you. You guys are my IDE, right? So if I do mistype, please tell me. That's true. It still worked, but it didn't replace the value. So there we go. So you can see here now it's in yellow for those that are not colorblind. It's filled in the values, and the values are replaced just like what you normally would do and expect with Groovy and G strings and multi-line strings. So that's also a good thing to remember. If you're working with Gradle files, it's Groovy code you're writing. So you can write methods, you can use all the things you can do in Groovy. All the collection API additions that have been done can be used. It's mean the world is open for you. So besides the one thing, it's with Gradle, the default file name for a project build file, it's build.gradle. And maybe you want to have multiple files in the project and want to use them, or just want to use a default different name. That's also possible. So let's change the name of our file. So let's call it createconf.gradle. There's a command line option. It's -b to change the file name, basically. So in this case, I should be able to do the file name createconf. And I can still do the project task. We still get the same result. So you can have multiple files, and using this command line option, you can just switch between them. But if you want to use this name as a default for this project, it's also possible. Then you have to change it into the settings file. So we open our settings file again for this project. There we have our root project. We have a build file name. And just call it gradeconf.gradle, which will be now my default. So now without using the hyphen B option, I still would be able to run this. It probably has to do with casing. Let's try again. Yep. I always tend to forget if the name needs to be capitalized or not in file names, but in this case it does have to be. So by setting this property in your settings.gradle file, you can just set the default name for the build file, basically, for your project quite easily. So like I mentioned, a build Gradle file project file is a Groovy file. So you can use all kinds of things that are available in Groovy. For example, also use the configuration slurper class, basically. I don't know if people know that one. It's also used in Grails, which allows you to load in a Groovy source file with different settings for different environments, basically. And you can switch between environments and have different values for different properties. And you can reuse that same object in your Gradle file. So let's go to our build file. Let's define a method called loadConfiguration. So there should be a Groovy file, which is a configuration file. So I will just name it config.groovy. It's not there yet. We will create it later. Then we can use the config slurper class, which takes an environment as a constructor argument, basically. So it can then decide which values from the environment needs to be used, but we can show later how to set the value. And then we have the parse. I think it's more than, well, that's right. And we can set these config object, for example, as a property on our project and then reuse it somewhere else. And let's first load it to make it work. And then we should be able to say, for example, config is object. So the one thing we still need to do is determine the value of this env variable, basically, which is my constructor argument. We can, for example, pass it via command line properties. And if we use the hyphen capital P, if we run a Gradle task, we can pass in custom properties to our build file. So use that feature here. So we just say project get property, just like this. So most of the stuff is now here. Let's create a task that will just display at least some information about the things we do. So I will just create a configuration file with one property. Let's say it's called location. So I can say location is. So the config variable here is the same as we assign here. So one thing to do, just create a configuration file. So people who have done Grails probably and Griffin know this. It's the same in both. So you can just have an environment block, and inside that environment block you can define your own environments. For example, there's a local. I can say location, it's local. I can say Copenhagen. Just rename it like this. So hopefully I've used the correct parse method, but we'll see. So I can now use the hyphen capital P option to set an environment, and let's set it to gradeconf, and then invoke the task show properties. And of course there is a yeah, it's even not complaining. It's complaining about something else now. The task is not found. It should be there, right? I created the build.cradle file, but in the settings.cradle file, it's mapped to something else. So let's fix that first. Ah, it works. So it was even the correct parse method. So to show that also, if I don't use gradle environment value, it shows my other location. So also I think that's one of the real powers of Gradle. You have a programming language at your disposal. It means the whole world of Groovy can be reused in your scripts, in your build script. So it's very, very powerful.
One question.
Yeah.
In your build script, you're wrapping the config object in an ext block.
Yeah. That's mandatory by syntax convention of Gradle, basically. If you want to set properties on your project, you have to use the X block to have custom properties. That's the way to go. And if you don't do it, you get a warning now, and then they say in Gradle 2.0 they will remove it completely, so you have to change it. So if I run it now, there you go. It now says deprecated dynamic property config with this value. So they really encourage you to, if you want to use this kind of dynamic properties, to use the ext block and define it that way. Because they will remove it in Gradle too. So it might seem strange the first time, but you get used to it. So now we have a couple of we have one task, but maybe we want to know how long it takes for Gradle to do its own stuff. So there is already a profile option on the for the command line. So we can say, for example, we want to profile how long it takes to let's do the complete thing and say there you go. Then in my build directory, there will be a profile report. So there it is, which I can open in a web browser. And there we have a nice little report about how long it takes the build to be completed and where the most time is spent in. I mean, this is just a small task, a small project, but if you have a big project, it maybe takes minutes, hours. It could be very useful to use this and see where the real bottleneck is in your build process, where the most time is spent. So this is just a summary. There's a configuration. If you have multi-project builds, you can see how long each project will take. Depends resolution. It's not applicable for this project, and how long tasks will take. So it can be quite useful. So one other thing I want to show for just plain Gradle projects. Let's go back to the build file. You can assign, there's already a version property in each build file. You can assign a value to it, which could be a string, but it could also be a custom object. So you can have your own, let's say there's a custom version object. Let's say there's a major, minor, and I will do a release. And I have to implement a two string method, because that one is used to set the value for this version property. So I will just make it easy major dot minor, and then I can say if this is a release, just don't add anything. Otherwise, say for example, it's a snapshot version in the code. So now I can just say new custom version major 1 minor 12, for example. So let's write two tasks, one that will set the release to true and one that will set the release to false. So I will create a task called release. Let's see, print line run. So this run task should be doing the So now I should be able to, let's see, this always bothers me which one to do. The thing is with Gradle, it's before tasks are invoked, it will determine which tasks need to be invoked basically. And if there are dependencies between tasks, it will build up a big task graph. And once that is built, you can intervene there. And now what to do is, if my task graph contains this release task, it should set the version property release to true, and otherwise it should be false. And just have to peek at my previous example to see which one to use. Or maybe somebody knows by heart, that could also be possible. That's not the one. Could it be this simple? Does it make sense? That's right. So I can now say Gradle run. It's still the environment stuff. We don't focus on environment stuff now. Anybody know by heart which property it is? Like this. Thanks. So now the run task is invoked, and there's a rule that if the task release is there, it needs to be set to true, but the run task is not a release task, so this works. So now when I do the release, it's not a snapshot anymore. So just another way to show that you can play around with real code in your build scripts, which is really, really nice. Any questions so far? Yeah. With caution, yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, nice word of warning. Thanks. So another thing I want to show of Gradle is the part where you can, for example, work with files, where you can copy files. There are some tasks already built into Gradle, like a copy task. And let's go to a new directory. So let's say, I think this is empty. I will create a new directory. Let's say there is a source main resources here, and just add the file there. So let's call it app.properties. And this is for you at gradeconf. And we can say app name it's like gradeconf. So we could write a new task in our Gradle build file just to copy this file, but maybe we want to replace stuff in there as well. And then we can still reuse some of the end filters that are available from the old days, basically. So people have used end, probably will relate to this. So I can, for example, use a replace tokens filter, and the replace tokens filter expects the source file to have some kind of variables in there, and those are basically enclosed within the at signs. That's the default. So when I create here my new task, so I want to copy my properties, it is of type copy. And I could say from source name resources into a build here. So with the from method, I just denote from which directory files needs to be copied and where they need to be copied to. I can specify it with the into method. And now I can also use a filter here. And the filter method can be used, for example, like I mentioned with the end filters, but can also be used, for example, with a closure, but I will show you the end filters. There is a replace tokens class, which takes tokens. And our property file contains this name. This is my variable name, app name. So app name is project.name. So here I tell my replace tokens filter that the app name variable in my source file needs to be replaced with real project name when it's copied. So replace tokens, it's not part of the default imports in a Gradle build file, so we do need to import those ourselves. So it should be org.apache.tools.end.filters. It is somewhere in that package, so I could now say copy properties. The build is successful, and now it should have in my build directory an app.properties file, and you can now see it contains the value copy, which is my project name. So my enclosed variable name, which was enclosed within the at signs, is now replaced using this filter. Another thing you can use in your source files is what Gradle provides for us. There's an expand method as well. So there's filtering, but you can also use the expand method. And that will treat your input source file as basically a source file that can be put into the Groovy simple template engine. So you can just invoke code there, which we would normally also do in Groovy template engine files. So this is for you at Gradecront. And I can also, for example, do some things here. I want to display the date. And by just adding the expand method to my copy configuration, I should now be able to see that now it's executed my code. So the new data has been executed and formatted. Now you can see it here in the output. So this is just executing, but also we can pass in, for example, model stuff as well. So we can rewrite our source file. That's the generated one. Here you go. And it looks like this. So now my source file completely is capable of being rendered by the Groovy simple template engine. This should work. Let's see the output. Still works, so nice. Besides filtering contents, when you do the copying thing in the Gradle, you can also rename files. It's also have different options. The thing is, if you look at Gradle, there's always different ways to do things. One of them is, for example, using the replace method. And there's a replace method that takes a closure as an argument, and it contains the file name, basically. And you can just, for example, use different file name and just copying one file, so that makes it easier for. Maybe want to change the name to app.props. So I can run the task. It should be able to do it. Let's see. It's not in this one. I don't, yeah, well, this shouldn't be. Sorry? Ah, yep, thanks. I only had two beers yesterday, but that's maybe too much for me. Let's run it again. First, let's just remove my build directories completely. So now it doesn't contain application properties, but it contains my new renamed file, basically. And besides using closures, we can also use, for example, regular expressions here. So we could just write something like anything that ends with properties. And then let's see, use different extensions could also be possible. It was in strings, yeah. So I can reference my first part before the extension and then use another extension here to rename it. Run the task again. So now when we look at the build directory, it now contains the createconf extension for this file. So it's really worth to look into the documentation of Gradle to see all the things that are possible when you do copying of files. And also note, if you do use Gradle in a Java project, for example, then you can use a plugin, the Java plugin, which will add a new task, copy resources, which is basically using the copy task itself. So you can also use the filtering and renaming in those tasks as well. Not the ones you write yourself, but those that can be provided by plugins can also be reconfigured, and you can apply filtering and renaming there as well. So when we talk about Java, so let's go back to a Java project. And create a new build file. If you want to do Java stuff in Gradle, it's nothing more or less than this, basically. Apply plugin Java, and you get a lot of stuff for you that you can be used. So to show what's already there now, I can use the task command to see which tasks are available in my project. So by just applying the single line, apply plugin Java, I get all these tasks, how to assemble something, how to do documentation, the tasks for helpers and verification, which are all added by this plugin. Some of these tasks have dependencies on other tasks, which are not shown if you use the task command like this, but there's an extra option. Use the all option, and we'll even show some more information. You can see now, for example, that the classes task depends on compiled Java and process resources. And you can also see now some of the dependencies between the tasks that are added to the project. So by just applying the all option, you can see this as well. So if you have a Java project, it is also nice to have at least some source code there. So let's write a very simple class. So there's main. Very simple class with the one main method, and it's still morning. I will. Good morning. Don't forget the semicolon. So this looks like Java, right? Yeah. Should be able to compile it. Let's compile it. Yeah, it works. In this case, I have my project, and my class contains a main method. It would also be nice to execute this class for my project. Maybe I want to do it. And to do that, we have different ways to achieve it in Gradle, basically. One of them is using the Java executable task. And it's quite easy to set it up. So I can say, for example, run app. There's a type called Java X. And I can configure here my main class using the main property. So there's my createconf sample app. And it has to have a class path, which needs to be the runtime class path, basically, from my project. So I can now say run Java. And I got a failure, yes. Source it. That is also a failure here. It says runtime. But they didn't solve it. could not find.
Say the name of the source code function, which should be the main or repo or something else with that runtime. No, actually, it should be main.
Main? Should be configurations, right?
Yes.
Yep. there we go. No! Why? I have a backup. This one worked. So it's all in there somehow, but it's different. So that's the main part of source sets, and that's the runtime part of the configurations. So this is it. Yep. So it's always good to have documentation besides your computer if you do stuff like that. But anyhow, this works. So you can use the Java executable task basically, but we can also use the Java executable method, which is available and added by the Java plugin. So for example, if I want to create a task where I want to have multiple actions, and one of those actions is to execute Java stuff, I can do it differently. So I can say there's a normal task. It's not of a specific type, but I can still use an Java exec method, and it takes the same properties. So I can now say Gradle exec app, and it still works. So that's one way to go, but maybe you're working on a Java project where the output will be something that needs to be runnable by other people. So we want to be able to create a Java file or distribution file, which you can just send to somebody, containing all the shell scripts that are capable of running your application just in one go. And there's a plugin for that as well in Gradle. It's the application plugin, which makes this very easy. So I could create a new file here and can say apply plugin Java application. So we're just adding a new plugin. This application plugin will add a run task, and the run task looks at the main class name property to see which main class is available in the project, which needs to be invoked. So I can say sample app. I can say Gradle app run. And now the run task is giving me the output of my compiled Java class. So just to make it easy, there's an install app command as well, which will create for me. There it is. So in my build directory, there's now a Java directory which contains a bin and a lib folder. So if I go into the bin folder, there are two script files. I can just invoke them, and then got the immediate answer. And it's looking into the lib folder. And there's also a distribution task that will ship all this and can be sent to somebody to be executed, and it will work immediately. It's also very powerful. Any questions so far?
Can you make a self-contained bash script, or shell script that you contain all the libs
in? The shell script itself, you mean, or?
Yeah, because you have the types of shell scripts that contain everything. I mean, all the libs and such. Can you do this as well?
No, I think the shell script, it will look for a lib folder, and that lib folder contains all the jar files necessary to run it. So you still need the directory structure there, but. Because in Java, at least you need some jar file somewhere that needs to be invoked, which contains your main class, basically, so. Let's see, if we do some testing in our applications, and of course we do. If we're now in our Java project, if we write a new test class, and I will write one very quickly. Didn't make it. Still the wrong directory. So let's go back to the root of my project. I can say, and I want to do a Spock specification. I can just say createConf. I don't think I need this one. So just do a very simple one. Most people know Spock here, or if you don't know it, try it and learn about it. It's very, very powerful. So I'll just write a test that will pass. Just to make it easy, so I just now need to configure a dependency. I have now a dependency on Spock, so I need to configure that one also in my file here. And I want to get it from a repository, and there's a repositories block, and Maven Central has been very much used the last couple of years, but also Bintray is really getting a lot of noise, and to use Bintray, there's a really nice shortcut there in Gradle. Just type jcenter and it will point to the bintray repository for you. So now I can say dependencies, there's the test compile dependency on Spock. Spock core, that's groovy. That should be it. So I should be able to do Gradle test. Did it? It should compile stuff, right? Yep. There we go. I did need the. So, build successful. Like we saw, it's just a very simple test that will be. Okay, but just write a test case that will fail. So now it says build failed. And if you're used to Spock and output, there will be a nice assertion error somewhere. And it is in the generated HTML documentation, but maybe you want to show it immediately in the console, which would be even better. So I can, there are multiple ways to do it. One of them is using the info. So I have more logging, and then we have to really scroll, but somewhere in between these lines, you can see this nice stack trace, which really shows where the difference is between what we expect and what the real result is. But then again, like I mentioned, if you use the info log level, there's a lot of stuff and noise around it. So we don't want to really use that one. But we can reconfigure test logging. So if we have testing, there is a test task here, and we can use test logging. And I can say exception format is full. So let's run this test again without the info logging. And now we can see immediately in the output my nice stack trace and why it went wrong, which gives you better feedback, short of loop for looking at why this thing didn't work. So it's quite nice. 5 minutes. I saw it now. So if you work on a test, if you use the test test task here, it will look for all kinds of test cases in your project, But maybe you just want to use a run a single test, so it's possible. There's the single test option you can specify here. And it then will just run that single test class for you, which can also speed up development if you work on just a single test case. So there's one more time, one nice thing to show as well in Gradle. If you use Gradle, basically a lot of the stuff you see in Gradle in the build scripts, it's basically a DSL for build automation, which is provided for you by Gradle. But we can also extend it. We can write our own basically DSL. We can write very simple stuff, which is already very powerful. We only have to write a class and assign it as an extension into the Gradle project, and it can be used. So for example, I create a new file. I want to have something, I want to have a method in my project. For example, it's called useSpock, and that method needs to set my project dependencies correctly. So I can do, for example, create a new class here, so it's common dependencies. I can say useSpock. So project dependencies, test compile. And there's the reference to the dependency, we can just type it here. It's always a long version. So I'm using here this project that still needs to be passed into my object. So I will just use a constructor for that one. So there's a common dependencies which gets a project parameter, and I can just it's not even Spring, it's not even, what was I thinking? totally different, but, well, hey. So there you go. So in the constructor, I also want to, for example, immediately set something with the repositories, which is possible here. So when I have this class, and I want to have this class as injected basically into my project, so I can use my useSpock method as my own basically DSL. So there is project extensions.create. And here we can specify different arguments. The first argument is basically the name of my base block, my base configuration for my DSL, which is common dependencies, followed by the class name, and then followed by arguments which will be passed into the class constructor. So in this case, it's project. So there, if I want to apply this, I should be able to just say use Spock common dependencies, use Spock. So this is now my own DSL to define dependency for my Java project, for example. The sample is maybe simple, but you can imagine you maybe have a big company, and this kind of stuff you can also put into a plugin, and people can reuse it in their projects, and they always use the same Spock version without knowing how to specify it like this. They just know there's a use Spock method available. So if I look at the dependencies, for example, it now shows that my project dependencies contains the Spock dependency I've defined there. So like I mentioned, I mean, you don't want to type this in for every project file here. So we can do something different. Just refactor something. Let's create a common dep Gradle file, paste it in there. And then I can say apply from . So with the apply method, besides specifying plugins, we can also use the from argument basically to specify a new Gradle file that will be included in this file. Now it's locally, but like I mentioned before, if you're on an intranet, it could also contain an HTTP URL, and it still will download it from there, and it will be used in, I'm almost done. So just to show this works. And we still get the same result. So this is also very powerful to refactor your build scripts. Like I mentioned, it's code, so why not refactor and make it more maintainable for your project? So my time is up for now. So if there are some questions. Yeah? What kind of properties are visible? I think it is. Well, we have code, we can try. So let's say, there's the extra property, and when I go back to the build file, should be able to just to simply did called extra. Yep. Somewhere is it somewhere? Ah, here. Yeah. Yeah. Another question? No. Well, thank you for your attention. Hopefully you learned something and enjoy the rest of the day.